Hi, everybody. If we're live, go ahead and let us know in the chat room.
Right.
I guess we need to get...
What's that?
Club.tv. Admin.
So, are we live? Are the people watching us?
Hold on, let me make sure we are on DiamondClub.tv. We are. DiamondClub. Yeah, awesome. Awesome possum.
DiamondClub.tv.
Sweet. Let's go ahead and put Twitter.
I'm going to get a drink of water because I like to drink water. Hey.
Oh, God, my back. Oh, my age. Oh, God.
All right, guys. Welcome. Mod Raptors letting us know live everywhere we need to be. If you are watching in the Diamond Club chat room, let me know so I know we're live and everyone's here.
Dude, can I show you what I love about Fry's Electronics?
What do you love about Fry's Electronics?
When I want to get some batteries, I can just put some batteries.
Okay. Oh, jeez. Oh, man. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, my good God. Oh, Jesus. That is a comically large set of batteries.
So every time my little Apple mouse or keyboard says, I'm out of juice, guess what? I got to whack it with the battery pack here.
Oh. You should just keep it in like a banana clip in a machine gun.
No, I'll strap it to my chest like Chewbacca or a Mexican, you know, bandit. Magically make it appear. Oh, you need batteries? Whoa. I'm here all day week, folks. All
right. Actually just totally fooled the pants off of me. I walked in just in time to see like a lightsaber appear. That was
no,
awesome.
I was talking about what I love about Fry's.
That's amazing. And then,
you know, our friend, Mr. Flipstick.
Yeah, dude, it looks great. Hey.
Low frame rates are your friend in TV magic.
Look at that. I took my old iPhone case, totally tore it apart, sanded it down, smoothed it out, and then epoxied it to the back of this so that the new iPhone Gigantus will fit onto my bike. That was today's
well, gentlemen.
First.
I don't want to brag, but I got a little delivery from the Apple people the other day.
Oh, yeah? What is it?
The case for my iPhone 6 Plus?
Here, let me... You might want to tilt pan up a little bit because your head's getting cut off, and that's on your end.
It's because I have a large head, Brian.
So you went with the Plus?
Yeah. Did you?
Yes, I love it. I was terrified that I was going to think it was too big, but instead it's. I was like, I don't care how freaky they think we are. We were meant for each other.
No, I know. You guys are my canaries. I was in Singapore, so I couldn't order it.
I get lying. And waiting for my upgrade cycle. So, yeah.
Oh, really? So when is your upgrade cycle?
I mean, I was like the 21st. October 21st was when I, you know, qualified. So, dude, you know, two days after.
To paraphrase the great Andrew Main, what's the point of having a television show if you can't immediately blow all your money on iPhone products the moment they come out?
I still have to... It's like the $200 difference. I just couldn't. I'm like, am I that? You know, because I, you know, I know the good and the bad times. You know, I know the Monday Justin and I wait for the dollar chicken McNuggets at McDonald's, and the Friday Costco hot dogs and sweet talking the sample ladies so they would give us extra portions.
It's amazing. Okay, let me real quick.
Now we're here.
Yeah, now right. We're here.
Give me some chit chat here.
I'm chatting away my chit.
Okay, Justin.
Hey, what's going on, gang? I'm talking everybody's ear off with my mouth.
Yeah.
I just moved my microphone because it was like a million miles away.
No, it's you. Actually, both of you sound real good.
You sound pretty good yourself.
Soft, velvety, dulcet tones. Hey, you equalize everything anyway, right, Justin? So,
no.
Don't.
Okay. Also, I don't do anything. I literally just, like...
Post it as is. Okay. I guess I'm going to... This will be a little bit...
Sit anymore.
I'm practicing good hygiene. I'm actually, like, all this shit's up here because, like, I'm doing voiceovers, and so, I literally have to shout towards the sound insulating foam because there's a difference between talking in front of monitors and stuff.
But
I've gotten into the habit of good hygiene and trying to hit around negative 12. So if that sounds good to you guys, then I say we're ready to go. I do want to tweet out that we're about to start. And by start, I mean start our periods. Bum-bum-ba-dum-bum.
You guys tell I just woke up. I have a wake-up face.
Can you guys tell that I was up since 5 in the morning till 9 with a baby that just wanted to play and Bonnie who wanted to sleep? And then finally I was like, screw you guys, I'm going back to sleep. Were you able to tell all that from the bags under my eyes?
No.
Were you able to tell that I woke up very leisurely and then... read two think pieces and then went to brunch and then watched football on my tablet.
I think we read all that in between the lines. Hey, are we on Diamond Club?
We are.
Oh, let me tweet this out.
We're live recording my favorite podcast, Weird Things. You'll never guess what it's about. I think I'm going to make the jump. Speaking of weird things, I think I made the decision to install a bidet seat. Just the Slate has a whole article about butthole washing, and I think it convinced me.
Ladies and gentlemen, those of you just tuning in, this is Weird Things. right now is, you know, bum tips from Ryan.
I'm just saying, yeah, as a matter, there it is.
Meshcom.
Because Brian is balling. No. So you don't care how much it is. Because you don't care what the price is.
It's right? $36 is the price.
Got three daughters. White people rich. White people rich. Buy an Xbox One the day it comes out. Woo! White people rich.
What? $36 for a butt washing.
White people rich. White people rich. If you have life insurance and you're.
What? I don't know. That looks
people rich. White people rich. White people rich. Fire brushwood, brushwood. White people rich. White people rich.
Amazing. So there's that. I still don't even have an Xbox One. That song is a lie. That is propaganda perpetrated against me.
I just saw NSFW number 189, which was entitled Cheese Weed.
Oh wait, that was the one. That was the one where we didn't believe Jackie Hearn until we found out it was Jackie Hearn calling talking about dressed up as a nurse with the sexy time in the car with the cheese weed.
Oh yeah.
I'll tell you what, man. We had some good shows. Too bad we died. And that's the reason NSFW ended.
Yeah.
Great. SD for GC. I forgot that's where that same t-shirt came from. All right, man.
I'm shutting down my Twitter stream.
Yeah.
Pulling up my notes. Are you ready for this? Are you ready to get weird?
Yes, I am. Here, I'll count you down, and then you hit go. Ready? 5, 4, 3, 2.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, ghouls and goblins, welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Mr. Brian Brushwood.
Yes. I always feel like I got called on in class. I'm like, yes, I knew it, that mentioning a bidet seat would get me named first.
Yeah, the pre-show here is always interesting.
Yeah. By the way, we record live on diamondclub.tv, usually on Sundays. We try to tweet out ahead of time.
So, Brian, why do we record live like that?
Why do we record them live?
I was just waiting for you to take a drink.
Oh,
and Justin Robert Young.
Hi, everybody. My butthole pledges to remain standard issue. No fancy technology for me.
I guess, man, should that be the first item? The Slate article about butt washing?
Sure.
Basically,
I can't kill that lead, Brian.
Yeah, Lex Friedman is a columnist. He writes for Macworld. I knew him originally from Cracked.com, where he used to do the news on Cracked or Cracked News or whatever. But he would do like the Week in Douchebaggery and some other stuff. And like he's like on some kind of tear about like bidet seats and full on said, you know, like retweeted Slate, like, preach on, brother. When Slate wrote a whole article about how we're all savages and why can't we be civilized like the Japanese and have warm, white noise generating toilet seats that also clean your backside more efficiently than, you know, paper.
Well, having been to the Orient several times, including living in Japan, I can tell you that we see like the sharper image toilets, the really cool stuff.
Yeah.
But then when you go to public bathrooms there, it is literally a hole in the like first time there, like I see this hole in the ground and I'm like, how do I not fall in? What magical levitation powers do these people possess?
I got in trouble for being culturally insensitive. I'm going to go to my Instagram.com/scamschoolbrian when we did the shows in Indonesia. They had a sign up that explained on the Western style, you know, what we would call just a normal toilet it depicted.
Yeah, it's a toilet. It's not a hole in the ground. Yeah, it is a toilet. It doesn't need to be Western style. Okay. It's a toilet.
Right. Okay. So they full on, like, it depicts, you know, I love the adventures of whatever slippery dance man that black stylized figure is. In this case, you know, the guy who's running with children or.
And sounds like a very loaded phrase.
But my point is, it depicts him squatting and standing on the seat with a giant no sign through it, like, no, you don't do that. And I was like, I didn't understand at the time. And I tweeted a picture saying, apparently this happens so often that they had to put up a sign, you know, crazy face. And then they're all like, yeah, they're called squatty potties, and it's the default for most of the world. You're the culturally insensitive a-hole who doesn't seem to understand this. And I was like, oh, got any gum?
So we talk about incidents of dysentery or not?
Well, I mean by the way, this when I talk about the guy, I'm talking about this guy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, at any rate,
for the audio listeners, for which is the only way that anybody listens to this, Brian is describing the stick man that is so often seen on signs.
Brian showed him running downstairs, avoiding a fireball shooting this guy's head.
All right, here it is. I found it. This is the photo on there of.
Oh God! So.
So here's the thing. So it's a photo of a guy standing on top of a toilet and squatting.
Yes.
I had a buddy in high school who his father, highly educated guy, I don't know if he had like master's degree, was an accountant, very, spoke multiple languages, all that. Born in a third world country, my friend's biggest complaint was his dad would get his footprints on the toilet seat.
Oh, like, my gosh.
How does he do that? He stands on the toilet seat to squat to use the bathroom. And I'm like, your dad who speaks three languages, he was born in a different country, is a different custom. I'm like, I was amazed by that. And, I mean, I couldn't even figure out the gymnastics of that.
And,
but that was the thing.
And understand, and first of all, we're not going to pretend that we're fair or good people or anything. We are all Caucasian Westerners who are completely
capable of being either fair or good.
That's right. That's right. But in our protected, sheltered world, it's fascinating. Like, I mean, this is, you nailed it with the whole dysentery thing. Like, there's a real problem, so much so that, get this, like, you know that India has a pledge program where you pledge to poop in a toilet instead of on the street. Take the pledge. If you go to Poo to Loo, that's P-O-O, the number 2, L-O-O.com, they've got this this whole, like, campaign video, and it's like, look, this is government money being spent on this, which, by the way, I guess that's 115,000 or 1 million. I can't.
Yeah,
really,
it's a weird common.
At any rate, it's enough of a public health crisis.
Wait a minute. Pan, no. Go back to that screen you were on. What we are seeing is a very well designed and illustrated, by the way, a UNICEF sponsored message here, a website.
And what is their mascot, gentlemen?
It's a marshmallow, a brown chocolate marshmallow.
It's basically the poop emoji, but with smaller eyes. But do me a favor, Brian, just scroll to the right, because
what is the logo above the pledges taken?
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. I believe I know what you're getting at. I believe you're talking about the tagline.
Yeah.
Enough of this SH*T, raise your voice against open defecation. And again,
worthwhile cause, by the way, because if people were doing nothing but pooping on my street, I would very much like to raise a voice about it.
Yeah, well, but I guess also these people are apparently on YouTube, because there's a YouTube video that I'm gonna just give some highlights here, but it involves
this kid is being terrorized by poop.
Yeah, like everywhere he goes, there's poop.
Like a dream I had the other night.
But you know what? I guess this is an effective tactic in that it is building up this kind of, I don't want to say shaming, but it sort of is saying, like, hey, man, that's not cool. Let's all be civilized. It's a pain in the butt to go all the way over to the porta potty, but please do that.
Well, again, this underscores the biggest environmental problem in the world right now. The biggest environmental problem is water. It's access to clean water and making it available to people, you know, around the world. And that's one of the problems, is you have people in environments where they don't have running water, they don't have the ability to get that. And so, you know, what we take as a luxury, we just take for granted, we forget. And the rest of the world, you know, while we're worried about one thing, you know, the real environmental problem is water. And that's what causes, you know, more deaths every year, is bad water access to that. And, you know, charities like Charity Water, things like that, and all these other things, which get maybe some criticism for being a little bit, you know, self-indulgent.
Trendy and sure.
But I still think they're great. I think they're great. I think that, you know, I have far more, I think that will do far more to help lives than, you know, my friends who bitch about the fact that some stores still have plastic bags. Guess what? You know, plastic bags in a modern civilized country will never hurt anybody, because they'll end up in a landfill 8 feet under.
By the way, when you said plastic bags, I thought, like, they don't even have toilets? And then it took me a second to realize you're talking about, like, from a recycling
grocery store. Everyone's like, oh, they still have plastic bags here. I'm like, yeah, because you know what? They actually end up in the landfills here, too, and they don't. I mean,
like,
I could get into...
A well-timed plastic bag might be a half measure against Poo to the Loo. You know,
exactly.
Like, you could have your cake and eat it too.
I'll tell you what, though, and by the way, if anyone is in you know, if anyone comes from a different circumstance, we certainly don't mean to disparage. It's just that this is fascinating to us.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, my point is that we take for granted so much, and then if, you know, we want to, you know, really help the rest of the world, you know, the things that we were lucky by the lottery of birth to be born into, you know, we forget that other people don't have. I mean, I did absolutely nothing to make this country the great country it is, or the Western world to have the money or things that it had. I just was lucky to be here. And people who are born into different situations that have their own wonderful cultures in many respects, you know.
Well, and I guess that's the thing, too, is as we reach a world, you know, if you read the book Abundance or The Rational Optimist, you know that everything is trending in delightful directions. But culturally, there are things that need to be updated. And this is the kind of thing you don't think about, because clearly the message of the, you know, take the poo to the loo is that you have loos now. And so now we need to normalize the idea that they are worth taking the time to go to, which is amazing. I mean, just fascinating.
Allow me to speak for bathrooms. They're great.
Yeah. Well, but that's something too, is like, though, is that we take for granted, though, that, like, you know, you're on the road, you can pull into a McDonald's and go and do a relatively clean bathroom.
Sure.
You know, other parts of the world, you don't have that. You know, you don't, because of extreme poverty, they do things to exclude people from coming in there. You know, they want to make sure that, you know, that doesn't happen. And where when you have rising income levels, you can, like, oh no, we can pay some kid to go clean it every 15 minutes.
Man, this is that whole bottom billion thing where, you know, just going from average poverty income of $1 a day to $2 a day. I mean, on the one hand, it's like, well, that doesn't sound like a lot to our rich Western eyes, but that's a doubling of daily income, and along with it, infrastructure and safety and stuff. And one more thing on infrastructure. I found this out recently. Did you know that the biggest power outage in recent history knocked out? How many millions do you think were affected by it? We'll say the last 5 years.
I don't know. 200 million in India or something?
200 million? What do you say, Justin?
201 million.
600 million people without power. Wow. That is amazing. And like, nowadays here in the West, like we've said this before, like, if you want to scare me, yeah, power just doesn't go out for me anymore. Which again, being a kid, I remember it was all the time. Cable always went out. Power always went out. Every third day we would have, you know, candles or whatever. That just hardly ever happens anymore. And what I think is fascinating is our dependence on information technology. You know, the fact that that even if my and again, I'm spoiled as hell. I'm lucky. I live in Austin. If our crazy fiber optic internet goes out, I can still. I ran a speed test and stupid AT&T wireless was like 25 megabits. It was crazy. It's, I don't know. It's insane.
Yeah. You're spoiled, Brian. We agree.
I'm a million varieties.
You should feel worse about it because you seem to be smiling in direct offense to those who have it worse than you.
Maybe a hint of gloating, Justin.
You know, I feel like it's really something that you really need to issue a direct apology.
You know what? I'll do it as soon as I have a number one rap album celebrating my opulence.
Well, what would it sound like, Brian?
I don't know. We'd probably talk about the middle class things that I do. Maybe the fact that I got some kids, you know, just sort of doing regular old American things. Wonder what it would sound like. But
people rich, what? White people rich.
What?
Brunswood. White people rich. White people rich. What? White people rich. Brunswood.
Kill it.
I mean, it might sound like that, right?
Sorry.
Gentlemen,
ready.
You know what you need to do with this affluence, Brian.
Your affluenza.
You need to go on a safari.
Where I shoot endangered animals?
I'd say you had to go shoot endangered animals. I just want you to go on a safari. Not just any safari, a special safari. I'm going to invite everybody here on a safari.
All right. I've never been on safari. Seeing the animals in their wild natural habitat, that sounds like a fun time.
This isn't like a trick for us to, like, find things on the web or something, is it?
No, it is not, Brian.
Okay.
Where do you take a safari into your backyard? Everybody's backyards, or front yards, or side yards, or the neighbor's yard, or maybe the grassy field across the street.
Wait, hold on. This is like a safari. I'm just going to go on, like, right around my house?
You got to go outside for the safari.
All right.
Now, here's what's going to happen on the safari.
Andrew, you've hit the uncanny valley of outside. Like, you're saying, like, safari in Africa, and I'm like, oh, that's great. And then I was like, well, I'm sitting on my butt inside. That's also great. And then you just told me to go outside, but not to anything, anywhere interesting. And that's something that I, my friend, just can't abide.
I'll abide.
So what I want you to do is you need a flashlight. This is a night safari, all right? And what I want you to do is the middle of the night, maybe a few hours before morning, take a flashlight.
By the way, the only safari like this I've experienced has been joining Bonnie on an exploration to find out if the kids have pinworms. Because that's what you have to do, is sneak up in the middle of the night and take a flashlight and look. Please tell me that's not what you're suggesting.
No.
Okay, good.
No, no. This is horrifying in a totally different way. Take your flashlight, middle of the night, shine it across the lawn, and you're going to see little glittering lights, like little tiny dewdrops, like little bits of water that fairies are going to come along with wee little buckets and harvest, you know, from the grass. Little shiny little lights, magical little lights.
Those are captured sunshine, right?
Could be. And you'll see them looking back at you.
Lots of them some places. So we're talking like eye shine, basically, is what it'll look like.
Eye shine. Now, they could be fairies. They could be tiny little wee trolls or goblins. They could be the souls of fireflies. Or what they probably are is all the spiders in your lawn looking back at you.
Wait, spiders do eye shine?
Spiders do eye shine. According to Io9, they have the headline is, "Do this spider hunting experiment so I don't have to." Apparently someone in the comments said this is something you can do where you can take a flashlight out in the middle of the night, shine it in your lawn, you see the tiny little reflections. That is spider eye shine.
Oh my God. Oh my God. I'm looking I just typed in spider's eye shine, and you get some close-ups. You see tarantulas with like shiny eyes, but
the third one over is not scientifically accurate.
No, I agree. There is a cartoon one, but this one looks correct.
Yeah. You'd be like, oh, it's so pretty and glittery. No, it's not. Run away.
God.
See, what if that was the secret to all those Twilight kids that were always shimmering? They were just covered in spiders.
Yeah, picture that, youth of America having their sexual awakening.
So beautiful. I want to kiss him on his lips. Ha! Got you in my spider trap.
Spiders. Oh my God, that's horrific. So what is? How many should we expect to see? And is there a best practices to see the most?
I don't know. I think it depends on the area and the kind of spiders. If you remember when Justin and I took our brave expedition to the spider forest. Remember this a while back? I found a forest near me that was just filled with cobwebs.
Right. That's right. And you guys went walking, and you said it was like the size of an iPad landed on you.
Oh, it was horrifying. It was that, Justin?
What everybody needs to recognize is that like, there is a very thin line between settled South Florida and the Everglades, for which bears a striking resemblance to Jurassic Park. Like, there is insane wildlife in the Everglades that very regularly is either living amongst you like 5 minutes away in some preserved area or is sneaking into your house. There is ridiculous wildlife.
Yeah. So like, I'm always looking for places to walk, and one park I found just not too far from me. I'm walking through there one day, and I go off this path. It says, oh, nature trail. I'm like, I like nature trails. And it's, you know, it's fascinating because it's like, if I go out this park and down a road, there's a McDonald's, and here there's this nature trail and this big. If you look at it on a map, it is amazing how much of our country is not developed. And even in your own neighborhoods and stuff, you look and you see these pockets of stuff. Next thing you know, I'm walking through, the trees are taller, it's darker, and then I see a cobweb, then another cobweb, and another cobweb, and then more and more and more, and realize I'm about to enter Mordor. It is just and it was just Spider Force. And then, you know, got Justin there, and we got attacked and had adventures. And
can I ask?
And we both moved as far away from there as possible.
Almost immediately afterward, we fled the state. If you were trying to attract spiders, let's say for whatever justifiable reason, like you want to infest somebody's house with spiders, short of just throwing, like, you know, moving a bunch of spiders into there, is there a, like, any kind of attractant or food that you can lay out to attract spiders?
I would imagine it's like
I'm afraid to give you this information.
I would imagine more.
It's a safe space, Andrew. If there's anywhere where we can ask this question, it's right here.
I mean, I would imagine more insects equals more spiders, right? So you would want rotting fruit to infect with maggots to grow a lot of fruit flies so that you could have a lot of spiders? That seems like a long way to go.
I think you could just put a bunch of spiders in their house and, you know, go forth and multiply.
Can you buy spiders?
Sure, you can buy spiders.
But yeah, that's why I said short of just moving spiders. I mean, so if you would just move fruit flies, I mean, I guess like at some point you have to move some sort of thing on the food chain in there to get spiders. That seems like a roundabout way.
Yeah, I don't know. That seems like very long-term planning. I don't know if that would just work or not.
So let's say for whatever reason you really, really, really got a thrill up your spine whenever you shone your light into the lawn and saw so many eyes looking back at you, and you wanted to make that look more brilliant. Is there something you could throw in your own lawn that would amp up the spider population?
Well, I'm looking up spider pheromones, so if maybe you got some, like, you know, spider scent.
How much do you think it costs? I'm here looking at Big Apple Pet Supply, which sells spiders and scorpions and whatnot. How much do you think an emperor scorpion is? Take a quick guess.
$6.
This guy looks huge. He has giant claws. It's like a lobster with a poisonous attack tail. What's your guess, Justin?
I'm going to go, I don't think there's a lot you can get for $6 on the internet. I'm going to go $25.
$49.99. Advertised as the best scorpion for beginner hobbyists. About our tarantula scorpions and insects. I swear, dude, I just want to buy all the kids Christmas presents on this and just have them cry. Now, $16 will get you a
Remember,
giant...
that was the last year Bonnie and Brian were married.
Rose hair tarantulas are these big furry guys. Those are only $16. An olive-keeled flat rock scorpion is only $23. Those are wild caught.
The bargain scorpion.
The Asian forest scorpions, 3 to 4 inches long, is only $14.
That's a myth that they're only 3 to 4 inches long.
It's a stereotype, technically. Goliath bird-eating tarantula, 5 to 11 inches long. I haven't scrolled down yet. I'm going to put it down at $80. What do you guys say?
100. I'm saying 100.
I'm going 50.
$129.99. Plus, it's called a bird eating tarantula. Yeah,
I don't like that.
Oh my gosh.
All right. So let's follow this direction here. There's an article that says, like, the first genetically modified children are, like, coming of age now. You know, the first ones that, like, we did some sort of gene modification, right?
Wait, is that true? Like, what kind of things do we do to them?
I
mean, not that I'm not. I just realized me saying, "Wait, is that true?" It pretty much was me calling you a liar, which I didn't mean to do. What I mean is, I am ignorant of this fact. Please elucidate me about what kind of genetic modifications we've done.
So, let me pull up the article.
Man, oh man, part of me just wants to buy all these bugs. But I don't have enough money. I'm not rich enough, Justin.
According to TechCrunch, the world's first genetically modified babies will graduate high school this year. The first successful transfer of genetic material was in 1997. Scientists injected 30 embryos in all with a third person's genetic material.
So
children
this is,
who have been produced...
This isn't trans species. This is within... This is...
Yeah, no, Brian.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, well, first of all, I mean, It's not the craziest thing. We're putting pig heart valves in people and so on. And you know, we got my kid just bought, you know, fish with, you know, jellyfish DNA in it that light up under a, you know, fluoresce under a black light.
Yeah, so this was for children who had like genetically diseases or things like that that they were trying to eliminate by using third party genetic information. So that's happening. There are children alive and well today, and short of being in some horror movie, are probably very, very normal. The first artificial inseminated child, you know, well, child of the product of artificial insemination, you had that born, and then you had like, you know, the XV, you know, the fertilizing the egg outside the body implant, and you know, those children are healthy and normal, and you don't even think about that now.
And not only that, but like the verbiage has changed. Like when it first happened, they called them test tube babies, and nowadays you just say IVF, and it sounds very, very normal.
Yeah, so yeah, you're looking at this catalog of horrific creatures.
Okay, well, but they're children. They're babies.
The demon scorpions. Okay. Oh, so
I thought you meant genetically modified children.
No, I'm gonna modify my kids however I can.
Fuck you, Brian.
sorry.
Brian, I'm gonna genetically modify the hell out of my children.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And I mean after they're born.
Yeah, I'll continue. The experiments will continue until perfection is achieved. And that will change because daddy, you know, thinks that it can.
Daddy loves perfection. And every day you're getting closer to perfection, which pleases dad.
Yes. Someday you'll have my love, my children. So we're not that far away from, you know, some MIT dropout figuring out how to change a few genes and, you know, make a house cat, you know, 80 pounds and like a cheetah, or how to like, you know, start modifying existing organs we're familiar with in just very subtle ways, triggering growth things like that. What are we going to see? What are we going to see?
I mean, first of all, I think we all agree with the standard assessment that whatever it is we're going to see, none of us will be able to predict, right? I mean, we all agree like, we can't, it's stranger than we can imagine the ability for people to.
I think that we could say that there are certain trends, like in animals, there tends to be a trend towards miniaturization.
Yeah. So I just typed in home DNA kit, and almost everything is paternity test stuff. Yeah. And then identigene stuff, and like basically, what are you going to die of? Ancestry tests. But along with that, you know, the
autoerotic asphyxiation. There's a gene for that.
Actually, I wouldn't. I believe it. Man. Okay. So if we're talking about, here's the problem, though.
Got a good guess.
All right, then you go, because I got nothing. Go ahead.
This is a tried and true technological in which popular culture inspires people for whom create these breakthroughs, either technologically or medically, like we saw with the direction of cell phones looking more and more like tricorders. I believe that we are going to see a genetically modified cat that looks like, and I hope I'm pronouncing this right, because I've only read it, and I can't remember how it was pronounced in the movie. But Bubastis, the Ozymandias cat from Watchmen. I think we are going to see that will be available for people to buy before we are all dead.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. And to be honest, I think you are spot on in your gut instinct. I think you went with a more obscure cat. Why necessarily make it one? I mean, I guarantee this guy will come along before we die. But I think before that, we're going to get miniature tigers, cats that are increasingly genetically engineered to look exactly like tiny Bengal tigers. Or maybe they'll actually modify Bengal tigers and just make them small enough that everyone can have one as a cat.
Can I tell you, I've done my research, and I wanted my Adrian Veidt cat for my own purposes, and this is the closest I could. I actually looked into like talking to breeders and stuff and finding out how
you could get an Ozymandias cat.
Close enough. Brian's got the link.
Yeah, I'm copying it right now. I'm going to paste it up here. We'll take a look.
Surprising.
This is a Serbian Lynx. Okay.
Siberian, yeah.
First of all, take a look at this. This is a Serbian Lynx.
Siberian.
Siberian. I can read. I wonder how the Serbian Lynx differs from the Siberian Lynx. But I was 10 years ago, over 10 years ago, when we were on tour with that country music tour with Brooks and Dunn, Rascal Flatts, Brad Paisley, there was a couple of days off and it wasn't worth it to go home. So I'm in Memphis and...
wasn't worth it to go home.
Well, okay. I didn't have kids at the time and we were poor. Yeah, so we couldn't afford, you know, the for a two-day trip home. So we hang out and somebody's like, this pro body painter guy... is like, hey, I'm going to go see a friend of mine downtown. I'm like, yeah, sure. And so we get there, and like 20 minutes after hanging out in this downtown loft in Memphis, comes one of these freaking lynxes around the corner. And you're like, oh, yeah, that's a lynx. And it's like, I don't know. You know, the internet's not on all of our phones at the time. And so I just remember thinking, like, lynxes, aren't we scared of lynxes? Don't lynxes? The thing was huge. It was like 4 foot long. It was as big as a. It was as big as a small German Shepherd, and terrifying to me, and very chill. I'm sure it was delightful or whatever. But it's like, I mean, are they totally tamed?
I mean, they're not allowed in some areas because they're still a bit wild.
Wild is maybe the softest peddling of killing machines.
Like, top level predators has never sounded so cute. A little wild.
I remember when I was a kid, I was with my brother and we went to see a friend of his house, and I'm walking by the doorway to this guy's sister's room. His sister, she was this immaculate girl. Like, everything was perfectly neat, perfectly clean, perfectly neat. And then sitting there on her bed like this.
Oh, wait, hold on. I'm cutting over to you. Go ahead. Like just.
I thought it was like a statue of a cat, long neck, and just staring at me. And it's very, very serene, that the room looked like something out of a museum, but then follows me. And it was like I didn't know what it was. It was like prehistoric. It was like an Abyssinian or something. I had no idea what this cat was. It was strange. And I'm like, there's a creature in there. But when I was a kid, we had a pet bobcat. Dad found an abandoned baby bobcat, took it home, fed it, tried to make it fit in. But that thing was wild. My mom like hated the thing because she'd open up the refrigerator and grab a chicken, like a raw chicken out, and steal it. And then... you know, it was not the most pleasant animal. It was eventually
away. How does it come? I'm looking at images of bobcats right now. Like, how does this discussion end where it's like, you know what? The whole keeping a top-level predator that's wild in our home thing isn't working out.
Well, ran away, so that didn't
deal. All right, well,
my mom said it ran away.
By the way, I just typed in bobcat images, and one of the top things that's showing up is a dude with his face all slashed to hell, which I can only assume came from Bobcat Goldthwaite after seeing one of his live shows.
Here, I got another genetically modified creature for which comes from pop culture that would sweep the nation in popularity should they be able to breed them to spec.
All right.
I got four letters for you. GIZMO. You get a hamster looking thing to make into Gizmo from the Gremlins. Like, and you ain't gotta worry about feeding that after midnight or nothing. You can do whatever the hell you want. It ain't gonna turn into a Christmas time horror, Phoebe Cates. You can have it running around playing with you all goddamn day.
So which animal would you start with as a base animal? Now, I want to kick this to Andrew. Like, let's say you've got your home DNA kit. What's your base animal to get there? Because I assume you have to factor in what already looks closest to it and also what has predispositions that'll be popular.
Well, when you visit the world of mammals and then you start going down into some of the some of the things relating to monkeys, things like that. And so, like, I was looking this up because I remember, like, your tarsiers, your pygmy tarsier looks a lot like one. I'll show you give you a link to that.
And by the way, the correct term is mogwai. Just for
is it?
Mogwai, sorry.
Honky.
All right. Hey, hold on. You're the one who called it a gizmo.
Oh, he's gizmo. They don't call when – all right, so when your kids watch Finding Nemo, I'm sure that they refer to the actual genus of the fish and don't just say, Nemo, I want Nemo.
Well, no, because they say clownfish, and they're pretty – they say repeatedly, no, I'm a clownfish.
Okay, and I'm sure all
are very – So lemurs, tarsiers, those things, they all have kind of like that you get like – like eyes have big eyes. I don't think that's why they're named that way, though. But, you know, those are good places to start.
Lemur is a good, and they tend to be fairly tame. I don't know why I'm getting bodybuilding women when I type in lemur. maybe because I wrote lemus. There we go. Are lemurs fairly chill by disposition?
Okay, so. Friend of mine says, hey, we got to go visit my friends. They're babysitting a monkey. I'm like, awesome. I love monkeys. And as Justin has observed, I'm the monkey whisperer. I am able to get great apes and other animals to sort of respond and talk to me. But we go to their house. It's not a monkey. It's a lemur, right? They're babysitting a lemur. And there's this lemur with a diaper, okay? The most hyper thing you have ever seen. You'd try to pet it, he would jump out on top of the refrigerator, jump on top of the curtains, and just nonstop keep running around. This animal did not belong in a house.
So that's a no. That's you're saying that you...
Yeah, I would advise against it. Well, I would say they're people have them as pets, but they don't want to be pets.
I'm going to give somebody in our audience a little web project, should they want to take it on. Shouldn't be intensely complicated. I want you to set up a website that just randomly pulls a Google image search result from on the left side, the search for lemur, and on the right side, a search for lemus. side by side.
Lemurversuslemus.com.
Can I tell you, did you see the Wonder Woman on lemus that you pulled up?
No, I didn't. I'm sorry. I missed it.
All right, go up to lemus, and you'll see Wonder Woman.
Going back to lemus, oh, it's the worst decision I ever made. I'm sorry. I did not mean to. Here, I'm going to do another search for images.google.com. I'm going to type in lemus, and oh, my God,
all
yes.
Right, see, well, don't click on it. Wait,
oh,
too late.
Sorry.
All right, what's special about that Wonder Woman? What's special?
I unfortunately read when I clicked that that's all painted on, isn't it?
It's body paint.
Yeah. okay, so I have a question. So,
but now, here, real quick, go to that full screen and then go to a random lemur picture. Click on that. I just want to see one, just randomly.
All right. There's that.
Lemur.
Here, I got one for you.
And then lemur.
I just typed, Brian, I put a link in there. You can click.
Okay, all right. Well, let me copy this. Copy link location. I'll throw this on here. Boom. No, wait. Oh, it doesn't. Wait, that's correct. All right. Which one's better? Better lemur? Better lemus? Better lemur? Better lemus? I think we should all have lemuses.
I tell you what, there's nothing of, like, for whatever lemus is, it just is like random pictures of either sexy ladies, people who got arrested,
or lemurs. Like,
I got another lemurs for you, a lemur for you, and then I'll find a lemus. You got to click on this lemur.
Man, there are a lot of sexy bodybuilding women showing off their butts. All right, so did you just send me this other one?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, here we go.
Now here, Brian, I got a lemus for you.
Okay, all right. This I'm taking from Justin. I'm taking lemus, and from from. All right, so let's, ladies and gentlemen. This is, by the way, all apologies to our audio viewers. I'm gonna do my best to describe your lemus, gentlemen. is Linda Hamilton with maybe 20 more pounds of muscle on her. She looks extremely tough. She is mid-flexing. She in every way has the body I wish I had. How about that? Okay. Your lemur is Justin Robert Young. Snarling and eating fruit with its feet.
So do this at home, all of you audio listeners. That is L-E-M-U-S for Lemus. L-E-M-U-R, the correct spelling of lemur. This is my favorite new thing.
So
is this
okay,
lemur.
I have a question real quick. If we can divert sideways, because I didn't know there was quite so much controversy about this thing. At some point, I forgot what rabbit hole I was clicking down, but I ran across the Soviet era. It's in the Prelinger archives. If you go to archive.org, it's in there, which means it's all copyright free, and I'll have to find it. But it's the alleged Friends of the Soviets production of the guy who kept a severed dog's head alive, allegedly. Now, and I understand that there's some controversy about whether or not this actually happened or not. Are you familiar with this, Andrew? Andrew?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Did you lose my audio?
Yeah, sorry there for a second.
I'm familiar. My understanding is just complete and utter BS, but I don't know enough to know.
Well, I mean, if you look at it, let's see, severed head. I'm just typing my name and severed head. Severed dog's head? I'll have to find it. There we go. 74-year-old footage of Soviets keeping a dog's severed head alive. Now, there's a scream here. Experiments in the revival of organisms. As best I was able to hear or poke around, like, people think part of it is, as I'm reading all this, it occurs to me, I'm like, oh, wait, that's right. The Soviets weren't the most trustworthy bunch in the world, were they? But there, no. There are experiments.
Chemical changes, as in the living animal.
So it looks like lungs inflating. Now, this is allegedly the research that made possible the heart-lung machine eventually. They have a heart that appears to be pumping.
An animal's head can also live in the isolated condition.
And then here's the
the plan of the experiment.
So it's a sketch of a dog's head with a drawing that says arterial blood is being pumped through there.
Right, and then it cuts to, I'm going to jump ahead a little bit here to what is alleged to be, and looks like, a severed dog's head, although they're obviously covering over the... I don't know if this is real, except for it looks like the head is moving or whatever.
And because you can't see a clean separation.
Right. But now what they do show a clean separation is later they show revival. They bring a dog to clinical death, and then they pump fresh blood in there. And okay, that's definitely poking him in the eye.
The dog breathes more normally and
man.
Evenly.
Anyway, the stuff that I read, and this is Wikipedia, so take what it's worth, is basically the film has provoked much controversy. Brukhonenko's decapitation experiment is what it is. I would love to know more about it.
Yeah. So, you know, if we go back over like 200 years, almost 250 years to Galvani in the frog legs. You know, he found out you could electrify frog legs and you could get them to quiver or tremor and it trigger the muscle reaction.
Apparently you could do that with just salt.
Yeah. And so we don't know, you know, I mean, I you know, revivification, it was like the frog leg stuff and all these weird animal things done over 200 years ago that inspired Frankenstein.
Right.
The dog head thing, it's just the problem is like we just don't know enough about what was trying to be done or what's done. And, you know, the idea that you could keep a head alive for a certain period of time, you supply blood and oxygen to it. Sure. Okay.
And there definitely is also in that same archive, you do have what appears to be good real footage of an actual a second dog head attached to a like it's a dog head and forepaw that What's funny is I clicked and then I saw this, Lemus. but like apparently they can keep a head alive, but then all I could think of is that goofy movie from the 70s where a white racist was attached to a black man's body. You guys don't remember that. I think it was Jack Klugman.
Yeah. No, I only know Reanimator, where the dude's head comes alive and then tries to do an unspeakable thing to the female lead.
So, can I get back to adorable animals?
Yeah, I'm sorry. That's all on me.
Before we get back into adorable animals, Brian, I've sent you another Lemus Lemur in chat, so let's just clear our palate. Lemus first.
Okay, real quick, coming up, I assume this is Lemus right here. Nope, that's a lemur, so let me get Lemus up here. All right. Here we go. Okay. ladies and gentlemen, here's your Lemus, which is an adorable, vaguely Asian teen with blue hair, and your lemur is Andrew Main.
with very intense lemur bearing into your soul with his gigantic glowing orange eyes while grabbing the frame of the camera for which is taking his picture.
Amazing.
Miss Lemur, ladies and gentlemen.
Lemus Lemur. So anyway, so you wanted to take us back to cute animals, because apparently all I want to do is talk about horrific severed heads.
Yeah, so you set up your animal camera trap, right, to take photos in South Africa in some sort of park there, right? And, you know, your goal is, you know, every time something big walks by or sets off the sensor, you're going to get photos. Photos of animals minding their business, patrolling around at night, and you could expect to get, like, you know, Cape Buffalo, maybe some rhino, right? Imagine, if you will, you take your photos, you go look at them, and there you see a buffalo staring right at the camera, mind you. And perched on top of the buffalo, almost posed, almost just as if it was just faked. I'm sending you the image right now. I want you to look at this.
Wait. I'm going to...
All right, you look there, and... You're like, no.
Oh, my God.
This can't be real.
All right. Yeah. Here we go. We're going to start off zoomed in. So you see the buffalo. and it definitely. Justin, do you want to take a stab as to what's riding on the buffalo's back? It looks happy. Just hanging out, riding on a buffalo ass.
I don't know, Brian. I don't know. Maybe a cat or a dog.
Not a guy. It's not a guy.
Hand over for anybody watching so they can see, too.
Okay. I guess I'll go ahead and pull it back. The guy on the buffalo in this case appears to be a bobcat.
Get away from the bear. Hope he don't chase. Oh, no, he's going to chase me. Oh, no, I better just turn.
So you're like, all right, that's adorable, right? Is that like a one-time thing? You know, no, they look a little later and there's another image comes up. And I don't even know if it's the same one.
Oh, okay. Okay. So real quick, you said this is a cat or a bobcat?
A gannet.
I don't know what a gannet is.
A gannet is related to, like, I think it's in the cat family. It's in the Carnivora. So, and it's a feline. So G-E-N-E-T.
All right. Wow. I mean, that's
Hey, bear! Bet you didn't know right. You was chasing
so another one. Now,
buffalo.
Every night, over a period of several nights, they see this thing hitchhiking, not just on water buffalo, mind you, or buffalo, mind you, Cape Buffalo. Take a look at this next photo, Brian.
All right, I am posting it right now on screen. What the hell? It's the same
rhino.
The same cat on a rhino? You don't have a song for Guy in a Rhino, do you, Justin?
I have a song for Guy in a Rhino.
It's a cat riding a rhino. Steal his horn, make some boner pills on a rhino.
So I found the fact sheet, Nightmares of Nature, about the gannet. This looks like some sort of animal evil propaganda here.
All right.
This is the gannet. Apparently, it spots prey such as a moose. It sneaks up the animal, taking small signs. It can pounce and bite the victim's neck.
Right on. It looks vaguely fox-like.
So anyhow, this thing gets up to like it preys insects, mice, rabbits. Oh, I said a moose, a mouse. Sorry, I'm like, oh. After watching it ride those things, why not? So anyhow, this creature, they've over a series of nights, they've seen it using riding on rhinos, buffalo, back and forth. And this is totally, you're familiar, like we know birds might do that, but they've never seen a mammal hitch a ride on another mammal that wasn't either a human or an ape, from Planet of the Apes. So this is quite surprising, and I guess it's pronounced Jennet, and not Gennet, like I said, a Jennet. So anyhow, here's this thing riding back and forth like it's got its own Uber, you know?
Actually, hold on. You said Jennet? Okay. Well, I don't know which one you said, but it's yeah, it says Jennet. You're right.
Yeah. No.
Dude, animals be weird. All right, so I got one for you. What's the... And this is partly going to be a function of number of iterations, how fast generations go. But what do you think the next big, fully domesticated animal is going to be in mankind's library of domination?
When you say fully domesticated,
I mean like as common as a house cat or a bird or a
house cats aren't domesticated.
I know, but I mean as close. I mean,
well, let me put it into a personal context.
Sure,
an animal for which Brian would buy Callie if she asked for it as she gets old,
or at least consider doing
that. You
yeah.
feel safe enough to buy for a young girl.
Because I'll tell you, my vote is, it seems like that's the movement on foxes, although foxes are apparently lousy pets because they're not quite there yet. They're still a little bit, they want to rub their musk on everything and saturate it. Or then, but then you think of like, you got fringy animals like marmots, you know?
I'll tell you two pets that my dad had that he thought, you know, were delightful pets once they were domesticated or just got used to it. He had a pet raccoon, of which I'm named for. And
really?
Yes.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Didn't realize this. Couldn't figure out, you know.
You realize you're experiencing a real life Indiana Jones moment. It's like you and your dad are fighting communists and you're like, Andrew was the raccoon's name.
Yeah, Andrew was the raccoon's name. It was Randy, and I was always called Andy growing up. And I'm like, where did that come from? And my dad was telling me the story about his pet raccoon, Randy. I'm like, huh, because I asked you if you ever knew anybody named Andy or anything like that. And you said, no, and now you're telling me you had a pet raccoon,
that's
Randy.
That's amazing.
Jim's Dandy Randy, and I'd be called Dandy Andy. I'm like, now I know. So my dad had a pet raccoon, which he said was just a nice, sweet raccoon. I could go through that. We'll do another episode. I'll tell you the whole story of his pet raccoon. It's like a Pixar movie. It gets lost. The police pick it up. It eats ice cream. Anyhow, he also had a pet skunk.
Okay.
And
this is amazing because the folks watching live in the chat, those were the first two answers they came up with was raccoon and skunk. And
well,
those
were the ones that are the easiest too. And I you know, that's why my father had like bats, things like that. But yeah, raccoons and skunks, like a skunk, once you get rid of the scent gland and it's raised around people, apparently they're like a cat, you know, and raccoons can fit in.
If you haven't seen it, you will feel better about the world if you just Google Old Man Dances to Aretha Franklin with the Raccoon. It is maybe the best thing in the world. I'm trying to get some audio. There you go. Anyway, that's why I like to picture your dad.
Yeah, pretty much.
For anybody listening, it is somebody who looks straight out of Duck Dynasty with
looks like Uncle Jesse, right? The Duke boys. This is what he's doing when the Duke boys aren't around. Uncle Jesse
is very domesticated and in love with the owner. He's just kind of looking at the owner like, what in the holy hay is going on?
It's the best thing in the world. Man, that is a fat
so,
ass record.
Anyhow, gentlemen. It's time to wrap things up here and go right into picks.
hedgehogs. Hedgehogs. Fully domesticated, trained hedgehogs. That's my pick. No.
Man, you'd have to figure, though, hedgehogs, you know, if that was going to happen, man, should have been the 90s when everybody was playing the video games. That's all they wanted. We're 10 years past date on when hedgehogs had their moment.
Whereas I think with raccoons, given success of a certain film.
For the
people watching or people, excuse me, like following the success of Guardians of the Galaxy, do you realize how successful that movie is now domestically?
No, I haven't peeked back in on it. Probably not enough for a slash film to win the movie draft, but I'm going to guess my gut says 180 million by now.
180 domestic, is it your guess?
Yeah.
Okay.
Justin?
Brian? Justin and I talk about this. So Justin, right now, Guardians of the Galaxy domestically has done $319 million.
Holy cow!
The 34th highest grossing domestic film in history. It just passed the original Iron Man, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, Indiana Jones, the King Crystal, Fellowship of the Ring, Iron Man 2, Episode 2, Star Wars, Attack of Clones, Pirates, Return of the Jedi, Independence Day, The Hobbit, Unexpected Journey, Half-Blood Prince, The Twilight, several of The Twilights, The Sixth Sense, Up, Inception, it's at $319 million. It's about to pass Transformers, okay? And by the end of the week, it should pass Shrek the Third. And
wow.
Probably by the time it settles, if it picks up another $10 or $15 million, which it maybe could, it'll, you know, pass Alice in Wonderland. And
I'm not going to lie. Like, my kids.
I also wouldn't be shocked if you saw this get kind of, you know, one of those little re-releases around holiday time.
Right. Yeah. No, I'll tell you, I would go see it again for sure. My kids are already asking to go again. In fact, this is my pick, is to sort of, detail our journey to explaining the whole Marvel Universe to my 10-year-old, Penelope. She wanted to go see Guardians of the Galaxy again. She liked it because it's funny. In her mind, like, I like things that are funny, and so this is funny, therefore I like it.
I understand. In the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it is only behind the Avengers and Iron Man 3 now.
Wow. That's fantastic and so well-deserved.
Which is, by the way, Iron Man 3, the first movie that came after the Avengers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That caught all the heat of how big the Avengers was.
Speaking of which, that's my pick, is to dive into the whole Marvel Cinematic Universe if you haven't experienced it. I started Penny off with Iron Man. She saw Guardians of the Galaxy, loved it. And I was like, well, you should watch The Avengers because there's a direct tie-in. And we're like, well, if you're going to watch The Avengers, you should watch all the movies that lead up to The Avengers. So we started with Iron Man, and that was a difficult thing because, number one, Iron Man, and this is hard to even remember, but there was a time when comic book movies needed to sort of prove they were tough to get your attention at the very beginning. And, like, Iron Man starts off, you know, with that, this cocksure arms dealer getting freaking hammered by his own weapons and waking up in a cave with a bag over his head. And it's like, that's kind of a lot to give a 10-year-old and a 6-year-old. But they held on until, you know, they moved on to the hilarious misogyny. And then eventually she got into it. And from there, you know, she loved Thor's fish out of water story. She was okay on Captain America. I think she's wrong on that. Captain America is way better than Thor. And then we built up to the Avengers, and the Avengers was amazing for her. Now she's caught up. She just watched Thor: The Dark World. She's gonna catch Captain America 2. She loved. Man, as a dad, it was so great getting to show her Iron Man 3. Where, like, half the movie, you have a chick in the Iron Man armor. I loved it. Gwyneth Paltrow, you know, the surprise real hero of the show. At any rate, that's the thing. And, in fact, it culminated now where I subscribed to Marvel Unlimited, the comic book service. And so she's plowing in. She's in the middle of reading all the Iron Man Extremis stories from 2008 and 2009. She's just plowing through everything. That's the whole Marvel ecosystem is now, 25 years after I wished it, is finally everything I ever hoped it would be. Congratulations.
I'm gonna show you just a photo. I was at a Disney store, and it warms my heart, like, to go in there and to see in these places, like the whole Star Wars section, right?
Yeah.
You know, and like with awesome costumes, but like there's the Star-Lord costume, but it doesn't come in my size.
By the way, speaking of Star-Lord costumes, when we were shooting out in L.A., I walked into, because they had air conditioning, I walked into a Express for Men, and I'll be damned if their number one selling item that right up front isn't a pleather version of the Star-Lord jacket. And it's like, that's what they're pushing this year. That's amazing. That's hilarious.
That is hilarious. Justin, you have a pick?
I'm going to pick the thing that I'm listening to on audiobook right now. And it's a little thriller. You might be able to find it in bookstores or airports near you because we've been getting wild sightings of it around the country. And that is a hotshot young author by the name of Andrew Maine's book, Angel Killer, a Jessica Blackwood novel, which I am listening to. My specific pick is the audiobook reading of it. And let me make sure. Here we go. Jennifer O'Donnell is the one who does the reading on it. I think she brings such a great dimension to Jessica's character. She does a great job of, you know, what is a fairly tricky kind of character to pick up, you know? It's not... you know, straight ahead in the way that you would think, you know, these kind of thriller stories are. It's very, very good. It's well told. The person for whom wrote it is on the podcast, so obviously I'm going to be predisposed to enjoying it, but I've loved the audiobook version.
I haven't heard a sample, so I'm going to play a sample real quick for just
Murder is a world away from me in the children's hospital. As I watch Elsie's pink fist close around the red sponge ball and squeeze, the scars on her hand turn red from the exertion. But she's not paying attention to the pain. When she opens her hand again, two large red balls appear and almost roll off her palm. Her eyes light up, and she breaks into a smile. It's a million megawatts of energy in a face half covered in waxy skin, still healing from the skin grafts.
And that's from the opening of the story that I believe is the opening Jessica chapter in which you sort of meet our heroine. But let me just say this. I've read in a bunch of Andrew's audiobooks. The reading of Andrew's writing is something for which I have a very specific taste and rationale for how it should be done. And I have nothing but high marks for Jennifer, who read it extraordinarily well.
That has been my favorite thing to watch happen over Twitter, is to see all of the wild sightings of everywhere. Andrew, your book is everywhere.
I just want to see it at checkout stands.
Yeah. Well, we've talked about this before, and I have to apologize. I pre-ordered the book, but apparently I did it on the wrong credit card. So
I did the same thing.
Did you really?
I did the same thing.
That's hilarious. And I just got a notification like, hey, by the way, you don't have it. I'm like, damn it. But knowing that it's on Audible makes it a slam dunk right now. I'm gonna jump in. I do all my fiction reading. I'm of course going to also buy it on Amazon right now. In fact, let me do that this very second, just because how – Do you know a lot, you know, okay, most of the fans of the show, Andrew, are savvy, by which I mean they understand the way momentum works and they understand the way that they can help represent and make their favorite authors look good. And there's enough of them out there that would love to make sure to buy your book in the method that will benefit you the most, whether it's financially or from a momentum perspective. How do you want, what do you say to those people?
I say, however you choose to enjoy it, using a free Audible credit or whatever is fine. If you go to an actual bookstore and buy a physical copy, that does the most, you know, and you would have this wonderful memento with the Diamond Club insignia inside of it too, mind you. Of course, that's the thing that's still in this world they look is to see. And I mean, digital sales, everything matters to it and all that. And And if you bought the original ebook version and you're like, hey, I don't think I need to shell out for this, but I want to know what's in this new, bigger, expanded version that's got like 30,000 more pages or 20,000 more words, rather.
30,000 pages extra.
You can email me, because my goal is not really to like take another dive into your pocket. Just email me if you want. I'll take care of you. I'll just leave it at that. Because I really don't want
to. Likewise, half the people who are going to buy the paperback are certainly of the people listening right now, it's probably not going to be their first copy that they're buying. So it's like, and that's the amazing thing is when you support somebody who does something independent like this, I've rebought so many books so many times and I never feel bad about it because I know that it makes a difference to the author and it makes a difference for the momentum.
In a different situation too, though. I mean, if you're a student or something like that, and you just want to follow the story, just email me and I'll take care of you.
The way to go about it is scrounge up $4.74. For the new Kindle version.
I want you to know that I bought it and it immediately said, thank you. Here are the bidets that you've been looking at also.
So I'll tell you what, here's what I recommend. If you buy my book and you're buying another, buy it at the same time with like Monroe's What If book or some other thriller. Cause like Amazon sees to see what's bought in pairs, what people buy at the same time. Cause then they'll say, well, people who buy this also buy this.
Ah, oh, dude, that's some next level stuff. I love it.
That's the next level. Like, you do your purchases like that, and they go, oh, well, if enough people buy this in, you know, along with some other number one best selling book,
when will you hear, like it, this just came out officially, like in the last week, right?
Yeah.
And so when will you see if it makes some kind of list or is that some kind of placement or do you, you know, intentionally divorce yourself from that?
I mean, here's the thing. I'm like, on Amazon, it can jump around on lists and stuff like that. I'd be curious to see. And I kind of look at it from my point of view, like, listen, I already sold over 100,000 copies to people who have Kindles and stuff. So I've seen, where that's gone. I've already made bestseller lists and stuff off of it before. I'm really concerned what happens in the print world. You know, where does it go in the print world? And as far as that, it's like I released Angel Killer, the first version of that, in like March of 2012. And it did okay. And then it just sort of slowed down. And then I focused all my energy on Hollywood Pharaohs, which did okay, but ended up being like the number three best rated mystery of that summer. And I just sort of said, I moved on. Like, oh, Angel Killer did what it's going to do. And then while I wasn't paying attention, Angel Killer just started climbing and climbing and climbing and climbing. And next thing you know, I have a humongous best-selling book on my hands that I'd written off. So
that's so amazing. And by the way, the reviews are stunning to me. 230 customer reviews. So that's you're into statistically significant territory. And you're at 4.5 out of 5 stars. And like it's amazing. It's amazing.
Yeah, if you go look too, what's cool is like the trade reviews from like Publishers Weekly below there, you'll see in book list and all that have been very, very nice to the book. So
that's so great.
That's been very cool.
Well, congratulations, man. I'm so excited for you.
Enough about me, guys. Now let me tell you about my picks.
Yes.
My first pick is Angel Killer by me.
By me, Andrew Main. No, I have two picks and they're related. I had to, I did a book signing in San Diego, so I picked up I'm going to be in New York by the book signing coming up. I'm going to be in New York this week doing a book signing at
Sky Pink. Sorry. Everything you just said.
I'm also going to be at Phantasma Magic.
Say all of that again, because we definitely lost all of it on a Skype
internet
vortex.
Yeah, I'm pulling up the information right now. I'm going to be doing book signings this week in New York. So come see me, and then I'll be doing two in New York. Actually, I'm going to be in. I'm going to pull up the information right here, and the. Let's see. I am going to be. Stalling as I try to find this. Here we go. I'm going to be in New York. I'm going to be at the Mysterious Bookshop on Wednesday. at 6:30 p.m. And then I'm going to think Thursday, I think I'll be at Phantasma Magic. So Wednesday, Mysterious Bookshop, 6:30 p.m.
Okay. New York City. Andrew, what day? October 1st?
Yeah, October 1st. October 1st. So come see me, New York.
Right on.
So anyhow, but I picked up an audiobook to listen as I drove down to San Diego.
When are you going to be at Phantasma, Andrew?
What's that?
When are you going to be at Phantasma?
The second, I think, from 12 to 2. Awesome. I got to pull that information up. So I was looking through different things to listen to. I figured when I drive, I kind of try to listen to nonfiction. And so I found this, which is interesting. See, this sounds a little maybe out there. Whenever somebody writes a business book based on some other business, like all the things like, the secret of Apple success by people who didn't follow Apple for years and really don't know why Apple's successful.
Right.
You know, I kind of avoid art, but this was interesting. The book title is called Make Art, Make Money. And it's by Elizabeth Hyde Stevens. And she originally wrote an article online when she's a writer looking for ways to apply her ability as a writer. And she went through this period of, I don't know, depression or whatever. And she sat down and watched a bunch of the Muppet shows and then said, you know what? Jim Henson's a very interesting case study because this is a guy who very much maintained his artist cred, but also became a very successful businessman, eventually selling his company for $150 million to Disney, which probably would have been $1 billion if he'd done it, but it survived and did it much later. But anyhow, she's written an entire book that's available in Kindle format and audiobook. It's like 10 hours about or 12 hours using Jim Henson as a business model, analyzing his entire career and how he was able to walk the line between artist and businessman. And she analyzes, you know, getting into different books that talk about this subject. Like,
We're losing you there for a second.
Gift.
Sorry, keep going. I'm going to, I'll tell you when you're back, I guess. In the meantime, it's super cheap. It's regular price only $7 or $4.89. I'm not even going to spend a credit. I'm going to actually buy it.
Buy it straight out, right, baby?
Yeah. For $5, I'll buy that and I'll save the credit because I'm going to spend my other credit to buy Angel Killer, which I'm so excited. I have so many talented, and you know how this is, Justin. Like, do you? We've got a lot of super talented author friends, including of course Andrew Main, but a lot of their works are not available in audio, and it's like I only do audio anymore. I ain't got time. If I'm gonna read, it's gonna be like up to the minute news or Reddit or some crap.
Yeah, I mean, it's fairly rare that I break out the Kindle and actually read with these old eyes. You know, it's just so much easier. There's so much more dead time in my life that I have to take stuff in, like when I'm actually doing other things with my eyes and hands. So,
that's the thing. You know, I would love to see the cognitive science. You know, we got different chunks of our brain doing different things, and we've talked about this before. But you know, Richard Feynman noticed that he could do mathematical things with one side of his brain while talking, but he couldn't do two, you know, talking things at the same time. And I think that's what, you know, driving or riding your bike or whatever are largely mechanical. I'm sorry we lost you there, Andrew. I bought the book since you recommended it just in this moment.
Yeah, I no worries. I'm calling you from my iPhone using my LTE. It is amazing. Like, it's between the dodgy internet I get here and then figuring out the new Skype interface.
Sure.
So she gets into and she analyzes it. And I found myself surprisingly enjoying it. She uses a lot of, you know, background stories, people, interviews with people who work with Henson, because, you know, Henson's a guy that took puppetry. He took puppetry and created these characters that we're all very, very familiar with, beloved, from the Sesame Street characters to the Muppets and the other places that he's put it, and built an empire and built characters that have, you know, he passed away almost 25 years ago.
Jeez.
And, you know, a quarter of a century ago, yet Kermit is very much real, and Big Bird and all these other characters that he was involved in developing. And so it's a very, but it gets into the sort of the business side of how do you balance between being an artist and being a business person and work with creative people. And I found part of it was very interesting because he talks about how, you know, he
he worked with friends and not employees and things like that. And I think about, you know, like the difference between if you're an artist, you know, you got to be, you know, you need to have your mind on business, but you're going to function and behave differently, et cetera. So Make Art, Make Money is a book. I highly recommend it. And in listening to that, it made me nostalgic for some old from Jim Henson stuff. And I went back and I watched one of the first TV specials he ever produced. He did it to basically see if things would work for The Muppet Show. It was an hour-long special, and I found myself enjoying it thoroughly. It was the Emmett Otter's Jug Band Christmas.
Emmett came out, Otter's
Jug Band Christmas. It came out in 1977. Music by Paul Williams, who is an amazing songwriter who wrote a lot of the Muppet stuff and is still alive and well today. There's actually a documentary about Paul Williams.
Wow. This is pre-Muppets?
I mean, the Muppets have been around since the late 60s. This is pre-Muppet Show. This is right before the Muppet
Movie. Yeah, I'm sorry. That's what I meant.
Yeah.
Man, I'm sorry. This is a black hole I could get sucked into. I'll watch the hell out of this. There's a reason we're friends with the Possum Posse. It's because there's something about that sound. Dude, that's fantastic.
So anyhow, you check that's available. Emmett Otter's is available on iTunes. And if you look, you might find it on YouTube in its entire length too.
Yeah, definitely. Like the clip we were just looking at was released by the Jim Henson Company. So there's certainly pieces you can watch without feeling bad.
So my pick is Make Art, Make Money. If you want to have fun, watch the whole Emmett Otter Jug Band Christmas special.
Man. Feels good, gentlemen. I'm sorry I couldn't join you guys last time to geek out over the iWatch or the Apple Watch. I did get my comically large iPhone Plus, and it feels so good, so right. I was bragging in the pre-show that I took my old iPhone 5S case, and I'm not very handy usually, but I totally destroyed it. I filed everything down. I sanded everything to smooth it. And now I've got a little like Burning Man looking thing that's epoxied to this clip, but I love it, man. It feels just right to me.
Very cool, very cool. Can't wait. I've got my case.
yeah, you've got the case. If not, Justin, how's life with the carrying an iPad to your face?
It's great. It's. I was talking with my buddy Steve, who works is the gadget reviewer for Business Insider, and he got both of the phones from Apple to review for the website. And you know, he said going back and forth between the two of them, he just found himself going back to the 6. That it's very
the 6 or the 6 Plus, the 6?
No, 6 Plus rather.
Yeah,
to the 6 Plus. Just because he enjoyed that larger real estate. I mean, it's very much on use type. You know, I think a lot of it is kind of curiosity. I think that's what drove the three of us when none of us were really particularly jazzed about phablets in their initial incarnation as Samsung kind of pioneered that space along with a few other manufacturers. But it with iOS is kind of a different story, you know?
And also it's the thinness factor. You know, the first phablets that came out were very, very thick. And, you know, the Plus is the thinnest one yet.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that was, I was not, you know, when I picked other people's phablets up, the thickness on that thing that was sort of got to me, and they've all gotten progressively thinner. Like I have a Nexus 5. And this is a hell of a lot thinner than the first ones that came out. And this is a lot much more of a pocketable phone than, you know, other ones. And so, you know, if the first ones felt like the Nexus 5, I would have had a different opinion.
Yeah. But, you know, I think there's a lot to it. I think it's rad. And the screen's gorgeous. Like for video, just sitting around watching video, like man, you can fall into it. It's great.
I'll tell you what, it's causing me to revisit games that I had originally written off. Because they were underpowered on previous iterations. For example, XCOM never played well enough on any iPad, on any 5S or anything, because it just wasn't good enough. But now that you've got this goosed up processor on there, I mean, this thing runs butter smooth on the Unreal Engine. It's fantastic.
So I've been playing this roguelike, or I had this roguelike that played way more on my iPad than I did on the phone. But it's called Wayward, but with the real estate here, like the to be able to use two thumbs and still see the screen.
Yes.
Just it's a total.
And I guess that's the one place where we're seeing lag, is a lot of the apps need to be refigured. For example, like in this case, you know, like XCOM looks great because it was designed originally to play on a 1080p thing. But if I do something more like let's say Tweetbot or whatever, it's sort of comically cartoony large, you know, because it's obviously not created to take advantage of the extra space.
A lot of stuff is just scaled up that hopefully will kind of look better as it goes. But to be honest, the real thing that's kind of going to be very interesting to me comes in the next week or so when they debut Apple Pay, which I'm very excited to see, especially in the Bay Area where NFC is very well deployed, how much that just kind of allows me to leave certain things at home, which is like the only thing that I want in my life.
You know, what's funny is I've thought to myself, you know, cause I ride my bike a lot and a lot of times I don't have space to, what I usually do is I'll put one credit card in my pocket and $20 and know that that'll cover me for just about everything. But it occurred to me, like there was a time that my credit card got lost or whatever. And it occurred to me that if I had just had a conversation with somebody who works at Wendy's and I just said, hey, do you have a PayPal account? Because I will give you $10 right now if you will front me for the sandwich. And then I think the Apple Pay thing is going to be kind of the final transition to this idea that money is a virtual thing that's always with you and that it's an idea that you speak some words and a payment is transferred.
You spoke the words.
It's going to be curious because it's one of those things where not everything is just a technology problem. You know, Google, I rooted for Google Wallet because I use PayPal. I'm not really in love with PayPal. And I would have loved for Google Wallet to, you know, them put the resources and stuff into there. But it was one of those things where it's like, you know, the actual implementation of Google Wallet on a, you know, on an Android device is like, you have to unlock, do this, do that, whatever. It's like, just pull out and swipe. Now that in part of it's getting, you know, working with the payment processors and all that. I have a friend whose father works at a payment processing company. They're super excited about Apple Pay and integrating that. You know, as soon as Apple Pay got announced, Bank of America is like, hey, we're going to be having Apple Pay. And it's like, wow. You know, I guess they're, you know, it's like iTunes.
Well, I'm sorry to interrupt. I was just going to say that it's funny how what at the time last year or the year before seemed like a stubbornness to refuse to engage in, you know, NFC payment systems. Now that we're on the other side and it's happening, all I can think of is how thankful I am that finally the juggernaut of Apple is saying phone payments and everybody's getting in line to make it happen, you know?
Yeah, and you know, it's just, and it was like iTunes, where technologically iTunes, you know, we had, you know, other things that did that, you know, that did. We had music system players, music links, and arguably better music playing systems, but it was, you needed a company that said, this is the whole ecosystem. This is the end to end what it's going to be, going from figuring out how to go from the labels to the thing that went into your ear. You know, with payments, that might be the situation here. I'm optimistic. We'll see. You know, I'm optimistic that this will work out like that. I love the fingerprint sensor on my phone, you know, by the way.
It is a quantum leap forward
and that's amazing here, because like I've played with UNS on other devices and they suck. On my 5S, it's great. And to hear that on that it's even faster and whatever on the 6 is super exciting.
I would get probably using it on my 5S. I would get, and it's funny because I always kind of compared it to like a catcher looking at a pitcher in baseball, where, you know, I'd hit the phone and it would try to read my my fingerprint, and then it would shake off the pitch like, no, not that finger. No.
Well, I'll tell you. Wait, I mean, last year I remember setting 3 of the 5 available fingers to my right thumb, hoping like I just kept putting the same thumb on there, like recognize one of these sons of bitches. But I'll tell you, the biggest improvement to me, and I don't know how much of it is processor power or how much of it is just iOS 8, but the voice dictation is utterly extraordinary. Which
it's another one, yeah.
I'm doing right now. Yeah.
Like, I almost wonder whether or not they're doing more of it locally.
Well, apparently it's writing down everything you're saying as you say that. So whatever it is, that's the answer.
Dave, you – so last time we talked, I told you guys about using when it plugged in and doing, you know, like OK Google or OK Glass, you know, what now they have Hey Siri when it's plugged in.
Yes, which I did enable and I felt weird doing. I don't know. I guess I
– Hey, you want to know where Hey Siri runs into some trouble? When both you and your girlfriend both have Hey Siri on your phones and somebody says it and both phones wake up to take dictation for whatever you want to do.
That's amazing. No, not you, Siri.
Other Siri, my Siri.
This is going to be that personalization. And I understand right now, you know, they're branding Siri as their universal thing. But pretty soon, and we've talked about this on Weird Things before, the future is 5 years from now, everyone's phone will have a different voice, a different personality, a different character, and a different name, and it will be uniquely yours. I guarantee you, we'll be spending $30 for the Jarvis pack in 3 years from now.
Right now, you can change Siri into a dude's voice.
Well, yeah, by going to British Siri, right?
No.
What?
Male Siri. Huh.
Male Siri?
How about... Let's hear male Siri.
All right, hold on. Let me... where do I go? I just go to, I assume, settings. I'm going to go to Siri, which is, I don't even know where Siri is. I got nothing. Do you have any idea?
Things general Siri.
General Siri. Okay. Allow Hey Siri's turned on. Voice gender. Let's go male. Oh, this is going to be weird. How far is Venus from us right now?
Let me check that. The answer is about 0 astronomical unit days.
Sounds like an asshole.
Sounds like the Uber driver I had in San Diego.
Yeah, no, I'm out of here. Get out of here, jerk. See, now listen to this girl. This girl knows where it's at. How far is Neptune from us right now?
Let me think.
See, she teases you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The answer is about 0 astronomical unit days.
Yeah, right on. See, I trust that girl.
I also want to let everybody know that I thought the tone you used with female Siri was patronizing.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to slap her on their digital ass. Come on.
Yeah, they've got it sometime soon come up with let you give it a different name because of like the Justin situation where every device answers.
Well, I think they'll be able to hold off because right now they have the distinction of only making it when it's plugged in. But I would imagine. Okay, so I figure it'll be maybe coupled with a gesture Google Now style with the Apple Watch. And then they'll probably start doing individual personalities, 2 years from now? Once battery.
I don't think they need to have individual personalities. I think you just need to adjust
individual that, names.
Yeah. I mean, because you can tell it to call you something else, and it'll do that.
Yeah, by the way, Penelope or Bonnie's phone still calls her Studebaker Joe, which I told her to do a year ago. And Bonnie she keeps forgetting. She'll ask a question, and he goes, I don't know that, Studebaker Joe. Man.
All right.
I feel like it's been some certain way, but I'm not the one to call it.
You know, we don't really have this much after show while we're still doing the show. I'd say it's been kind of weird.
Nicely done, gents. Yeah.
What do you guys think for a title?
God. So we had our Jennet.
We had severed heads. We had lynxes and minxes. What about lynxes and minxes?
Lynxes and minxes. Oh, my. Yeah, lynxes and minxes. So, can I tell you what's funny is like every time I go to look at, let's say, like an Apple review now, I would click on something, and it was amazing, because the first part is like, let me state clearly that Android's great. It's got a lot of wonderful features, and da 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 da. Because it's like this. It's crazy how if you just talk about like what you like about Apple, all of a sudden you get like angry.
You know what it is?
Android.
It's the inverse of the Windows problem. You couldn't tell
Back
anyone.
In the 90s,
yeah, you couldn't tell anyone how great Windows 95 was without the freaking Apple Mackies going like, and you're like, that's not English. And they're like, English.
Yeah.
And you're like, why are you talking that way? And you're like, stop copying me.
It's weird because it's like, hey, I'm a guy that's, I'm like, I use a lot of Google services. I have, you know, I have an Android device that I use for fun for other stuff. But I'm an Apple guy. And like, you know, when there's some feature or whatever or it's on Android, I'm like, cool, great, that's cool. You know, that's good. If it's really good, then someday I'll get it, you know, or whatever, and figure that stuff out. But it's just, you know, it's weird, the vitriol. It's just amazing.
You know what it is? It's that
it comes from the top too. Like I saw during football today, Samsung has decided to go all in on this like comment thread strategy for how to talk about the iPhone, where it's basically like, hey, by the way, we had big phones first and everybody made fun of us. And they literally just read like bad reviews of the first Note about how big the Note was. But now everybody loves them because Apple did it. Well, guess what? People are noticing. And then like read people on Twitter saying like, is it just me or does the iPhone 6 Plus look like a Samsung without the stylus? And it's like,
you know, even when we had the, you know, Apple is doing, and Apple's the underdog doing the Apple PC ads with Hodgman and Justin Long. You know, they got Hodgman to play it, and not like John Malkovich is an evil villain.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
It was still like
a well-intentioned but ignorant, nerdy goofus. Yeah.
Yeah, still likable. You still liked it. You didn't feel bad for, too. You know?
Yes.
Like, he was the one that everybody liked about those. I mean, like, nobody was really a gigantic Justin Long fan, but John Hodgman, you know, between that you know, kind of exploded his fake facts book kind of career into the stratosphere.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No, in a huge way. It's funny to see those moments of synergy where selling out, I'm using air quotes, to an ad campaign actually defines you. Like Moby's career was basically made for all the car ads that his shit ran on, you know? It's Fatboy Slim stuff or Groove Armada. All my examples are from 14 years ago because that's when I noticed this. But it's astonishing when what traditionally is associated with a move being, you know, a bad idea turns out to be the best thing.
You know, in the audiobook I recommended, Make Money, Make Art, talks a lot about when Jim Henson was making commercials. And, you know, his love-hate relationship with that, but the commercials gave him the money and the resources to eventually develop characters he could use for Sesame Street and then the Muppets and stuff like that. And
that's certainly what, you know, Dan Trachtenberg is enjoying right now. You know, he did a lot of commercial directing, and now he's doing that project with Bad Robot that was on Slash Film. And unfortunately, the Why the Last Man thing, did you read the statements on that? On the Why Last Man rights reverting?
I saw the thing just briefly where he said that, you know, they reverted back.
Yeah, and I believe in there really was kind of a no hard feelings vibe from Dan Trachtenberg saying like, hey man, it didn't work out in time. The rights are reverting. And you know what? They belong in Brian K. Vaughan's hands because he seems to really think that Why the Last Man should only be a comic book. And that's what the creator wants, and so that's great.
Yeah. I mean, it's having seen the behind the scenes of that whole process is fascinating. Not his, but, you know, my own experience is that, because you see something that you see sometimes get very, very far away from, and not from like necessarily the pure artist point of view, but like, no, this is not what it's about.
Right.
You know,
this isn't the point of it. This isn't the message I was trying to put out or whatever. It's
there's an A, B, and a C here. And we lost all those just to try to satisfy what some exec said in an offhand comment.
Well, and that's the other thing, too.
What other movie was popular a year before this happened to go into development? And let's say, theoretically, that Why the Last Man, in the direction of it, they wanted to make it more of a straight-ahead, Bourne-style action-adventure political intrigue thing as opposed to a, like, a very unique post-apocalyptic, gender-flipped world. Because Bourne was very successful and they wanted to have an action property as opposed to something that was, I think, at its strength, way more meaty and thought-provoking, then, yeah, you might say, I would rather this not exist than...
Oh, and on that note, you look at that, like what happened with the Bourne franchise is, you know, we got a Jack Ryan movie with capable talent all the way around, but we lost sight of what made Jack Ryan really cool and interesting. He's this bookish guy who spends his time behind a desk solving international dilemmas with ingenuity. And then we get a Bourne movie.
Yeah.
And then you get with the Bourne identity, and then we put, you know, Jeremy Renner in there. And even then, all of a sudden, like, they can't even ape their franchise.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with that 100%. And it is so weird. I just read, I don't know if it was, I think it was the 48 Laws of Power I just read. And in it, it talks about how you, it's written as though you are a courtesan in some kind of king's court. And it's sort of this tongue-in-cheek, like, how-to guide, but it's really, if you read it as, you know, a cold analysis of how people in the past have gotten ahead, then it seems less douchebaggy. But one of the things it was talking about was Da Vinci did David. No, Michelangelo did David, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Michelangelo had a
patron. But he probably did do Da Vinci.
Yeah. Zing. Apparently the patron that was paying him when he was doing David came in and said that the nose was all wrong or whatever. And so he was like, oh, well, come on over here. Let me get you set up, and set him in a particular position to where he knew he could chip away at some shit that would not make any difference whatsoever. But the patron would see marble fleck down into his eyes, and then he would say, now take a look. And literally nothing had changed, but he would be like, oh my gosh, yeah, that's much better. And it's like, it's all I could think of was Hollywood when I was reading that scene. It's like, that's everything is like, everyone just wants to have a thing to say. So it's like, let them say their thing, hand them the exact same thing again, and then watch them talk about how much better it is this time, you know? Not that I'm speaking about any specific incidents in Hollywood at all.
No. Make money, make art gets into a bit about that too.
What's that, Justin?
I said, you're not speaking about any specific incidents because you're speaking about all of them.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
It's fascinating. I guess I noticed that. I forget what it was. I think it was in high school theater. I noticed that if you listened intently to the director, nodded and say, I'll focus on doing it that way this time, and then said it the exact same way, they would always be like, yeah, so much better now. And it's like,
I had one of my first things I did when I worked at a magic shop, I used to have to do create packaging and stuff for the tricks we manufactured. Mm-hmm. And I had a boss there that just didn't like any of the ones I did. And so finally I took his face, traced it into it, and then put a Swami hat on him. He goes, yeah, I like this. I don't think he realized it was his own face.
No kidding. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Well, I've got to go, find out what disasters await me downstairs.
Yeah, right. Buddy.
Kids, it's good crazy. Yeah, man. Congratulations. In all sincerity, Andrew, I've giddily watched all of the sightings of your book in the wild, and I can't wait to hear how well it's doing. I mean, by all accounts, it looks like, you know, certainly on the review side, everyone's really pleased with it.
Yeah, we'll see.